So today, today we have a seminar by Massimo Lamanna. Massimo got a PhD from the University of Trieste, and he worked on high energy physics, and he started going to the CERN. And since 1988, he's working at CERN in different things. He is section leader on the IT computer systems department, and he's going to talk to us about the way they handle the large amounts of data that they have accepted. How you are aware that the CERN generates very nice, interesting experiments in physics, but of course all those nice results come after a lot of data that has to be analyzed and stored and managed and all that. Massimo, that is an expert on that, is going to tell us what are the things that they do there to manage all this data, which are some of them custom made and specially designed for the big amounts that they have and for the needs that they have. Massimo,
thank you. Thank you, Pere. Thank you for the presentation and also for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here for me. So the title I chose for the seminar is Big Data Services at CERN. So I will start saying what is big data, what is my interpretation of big data, and then tell you about CERN and what is the role of big data at CERN. So this is I took it from Wire, from this magazine, and is not super recent, but really gives you a little bit the flavor of who are the big players in the data arena these days. So these circles are proportional to the number of terabytes of data. Often these quantities are, you should think to quantities which are received in a year by, for example, Facebook. And you see that by far the largest things you get just a small part are the data generated by emails, which is completely unstructured, to a large extent are not scanned, are just human to human more very often. It's almost 3 exabytes, so it's 3,000 petabytes. Then going to big things we all know, this is the size of the upload in Facebook in 2013. This is the Google search index. Again, we are in the 200 petabytes, 100 petabytes range. Then there is a big archives called Kaiser Permanente, which is health records in the US. Again, very large. And then we are here, where this is just, in quotes, what the LHC produced in 1 year. It's not the size of our archive, I will tell you more later. It's just what the LHC experiments produced in 2012, which is the last year we really took data on LHC. Then in beginning of 2013, we stopped the machine to make an upgrade of the machine, and now the machine has been restarted a few weeks ago, and data taking will start beginning of June. So these are clearly big data, so we are talking about things which are in the many petabytes, tens or more petabytes range. But this is not the whole story. I took, again, this is from Wired. What is big data? This is a nice cartoon, they did it. And they define big data once you have big volumes, and what was in the previous parts is big volumes, of course. Then this data have to be, the system has to be characterized at a certain velocity. Velocity means speed, of course, but they like this VVV, okay? Velocity here means that it's not sufficient to have a lot of disks or tape full of data to say this is big data, because this could be just the things you shelved somewhere, you forget about it, it's a lot of bytes, but it's of no use. But if your archive is very active, so many people are going and using a substantial part of it repeatedly, then you have got a certain velocity. There is no definition of what it is in, you know, in bytes per second. It's more the concept of something which to have an active archive. The third thing, so the third V, is variety. So data which are trivial, data which are not containing interesting information, or this information is kind of, let's say, too simplistic, I would say, then they say that this has not too much variety. But if the information is interesting, then you also get something which is in this big data system. And of course, for physics, we believe that our data. So to conclude this small part and trying to play with this thing, I took a cartoon from my favorite internet cartoonist, Randall Munro, where it essentially it says that handling with data, even nowadays, is a bit difficult compared to how easy other things are. So my proposal for the fourth V is very difficult. So I'm coming from CERN. CERN, as you know, is a scientific institution, is an international scientific institution which has been founded in 1954, so more than 60 years ago. Almost at the end of the Second World War, so it's clearly there is research in our mandate, and also science for peace, which is something we are very proud of. Our mandate is, of course, to perform fundamental physics, nuclear physics initially, and now what we call particle physics. But we have also in our mandate the fact that we have to provide an environment for training physicists and engineers. We are not a university, we do not give PhDs or diplomas or some things, but many of us perform part of an essential part of their training, participating, for example, in an experimental survey. Although it's fundamental research, there are a lot of, in order to be at the forefront of fundamental research, you also develop things which might have other applications. So the third point of our mandate is also to do with technology transfer. And last, but not least, is for foster international collaborations. To give you an idea, now there are 21 member states. Spain is one essentially European, although last year we got Israel. And among the observers, which are countries which are a little bit, not really in the backbone of the organization, but they are very actively contributing to it, we had India, Japan, Russia Federation, Turkey, and United States. How big is it? So there are around 2,000 staff. But what is very, very peculiar of our organization is that we are hosting about more than 10,000 what we call users. In this university, probably you would call them visiting professors. So we are dominated by people which are not belonging to them. Primarily to the organization, they are collaborating with us and they are coming and going very, very frequently. I think this kind of strange ratio is a bit unique. Going back to the fundamental research, our flagship activity now is LHC. LHC is the largest scientific instrument we know of. It is hosted in a 27 kilometer ring tunnel. And this is an Austin machine which is capable to accelerate and let collide particles at the highest possible energy nowadays. So this is at the top of the what we call energy frontier. Collisions of particles have to be observed, and to observe it, we have four main experiments located in four points around the ring. And this is a picture of the construction of one of those, actually the biggest, which is called Atlas. To give you an idea, also from the sociology, there are about 3,000 people, scientists working on it, where scientist means physicists, say with a PhD, people working for a degree in physics, and engineers. In the case of Atlas, they are coming from 38 countries, so broader than the bulk, the member states. And from a total of more than 170 universities and laboratories. The size is let's say, all these experiments look a little bit like a barrel. This is the structure, and this one is long, is 46 meters long from one area, from the, let's say, the two extremes, and the diameter of this barrel is approximately 25 meters. Since there are these big numbers, I think you won't be surprised that also the computing for these detectors is so complicated and so big, etc. What I think is interesting is that the computing itself is a collaboration, is being delivered through a collaboration which we call Worldwide LHC Computing Grid, which as today is a federation of about 200 sites, 200 computer centers located essentially worldwide, I mean the four corners of the globe. This is not just a federation of sites, there is also a structure in these federations. So CERN is at the center because, and I will discuss this later, has a special role. We call it level zero or tier zero. Then there is a set of 13 level one or tier one centers. And then there, all the other sites are called, typically are called tier two, sometimes they're also called tier three. So all the infrastructure is needed, so all the CPUs which are deployed across the 200 sites, all the storage is needed in order to make LHC program, the physics program, a success. Otherwise, we would not have enough computing power to do the simulation, to do the simulation preparation, to do the reconstruction, the analysis. In the Iberic Peninsula, this is not perfect, probably there are some small, but let's say the most important, your tier one in this area is Barcelona at PIC, which is which more or less oversees sites which are essentially in Spain and in Portugal, in particular in Valencia, in Madrid, in Barcelona itself, there is a tier two for physics at the university, Santiago, and then also Lisbon, Coimbra, and there are also special links with tier twos in the South American area. So what we do is, as I said, the entire WCG is needed to perform our physics or to allow the physics to have the results. CERN alone, which is the biggest center, is responsible or accountable for about 20% of the total. So all the rest, the 80%, is coming from sites like, let's say, Barcelona, like Valencia in this area, and others in the other areas of the collaboration. On the other hand, CERN has some special, let's say, responsibilities. The first one, and that's why it's called Tier Zero, is that we are close to the experiment, we are receiving the data, so we are the first to see the data. And then we are also a big center for analysis, of course. And I will explain a bit later what it is. Where are we located? As you know, we are next to Geneva, on the French-Swiss border next to Geneva. This is a view of part of CERN. This is our computer center. This is an internal view of the computer center. I think it's interesting to note that recently, a couple of years ago, essentially, we ran out of total power, electrical power in this area. So this was not possible to have more computers and more storage in that area. So we went for an extension, which has by a tendering process at the European level, eventually an institute in Budapest won. So now we are heading to a system which has half the installed in Geneva and the other 50% roughly in Vigner. So they behave like, you know, different rooms where you have computers. As you know, most of the operations can be done, let's say, remotely. What is really interesting is unique is not so much so to have different rooms with computers. What is really unique is that the distance between these two sites is roughly 1,000 kilometers. It's roughly 1,000 kilometers, and across we have two links. Both are 100 gigabit links. And you see they are taking different paths in order to be, let's say, one is also the backup of the other. But on the other hand, the physical distance makes things in such that talking with the computer across these two machine rooms will cost around 20 milliseconds, and this is clearly non-compressed. So how does it work a bit, the computing? So here I have a few cartoons. At the beginning you have the experiments which are built around the collision points. So in the cartoon you see two particles, normally a bunch of particles, colliding in the center, producing a lot of particles going out. In going out, they traverse different layers of the detector, which are sensitive to the particle. And so the information about positions can be recorded, digitalized, and sent out. This information would be way too big, way too much for any system today. So what the experiment is doing is effectively is filtering here. So filtering means that some of the detector, some of the events, some of the collisions are, let's say, not red, or if they are red, they can be discarded. The reduction factor in data rates is about 1,000. So they are very careful to keep, of course, interesting the results of interesting collisions while removing uninteresting collisions. This is done next to the experiment in by hardware and by computing farms. And normally what they send out, once the experiment is running, are rates of data in the order of a few hundred, 1,000 megabytes per second. What is impressive is not so much the rate, but the fact that an experiment runs, for example, this year we expect to start in June and to run until December. In normal years, we start in April, more, or March, April, and we run for the entire year. So you understand that at this rate you will accumulate a lot of data. Once the experiment has decided which are the interesting data, via fiber they send it to the computer center. Here there is the underground LHC, the detectors are here, there is a filtering which is done here, a filtering which is done here, and then data are converging on the computer center, so where we are. So they converge from the experiments. And then what we do, we are essentially three important things. One is we put them on tape. Immediately there is a second copy on a different type of media in order not to lose the data. The second thing we do is that with our CPU farm, which is order of 100,000, all the data are reconstructed. So all the events are scanned in details and information about the tracks are produced. For later use. It's important in particular because with such a long period of running, you can detect immediately if there is something wrong in your detector, so you can take action instead of waiting 6 months and discover that things could have been done better. The third important thing is that we inject this data into the WLCG. So we are the primary hub to distribute the data everywhere else. So this is more or less what we call reconstruction. What is analysis then? Once the data are distributed and are, let's say, more or less everywhere, physicists, and here we are talking about hundreds of people, they say, look, I would like to see this data. I would like I ask myself how many times I find this kind of configuration. This can be seen as a query, which now is a query across the entire WLCG. So data are replicated in several places. So they are, let's say the query of the user is split essentially where in computer centers where there are data which are interesting, there is some processing and the user gets the results. The two activities are drastically different. The first one is organized, is done by one team in an entire collaboration, for example in Atlas, in CMS, these are the two big experiments, while this activity of analysis is done by hundreds of people. In a completely uncoordinated way, I would say. How do, at CERN, what we have put in place in order to deal with the data, with all the data which are, we are getting from the experiment? So during the recent months, we have prepared the infrastructure for the round two, so the new round of data taking, which starts in a month. We have deployed around 200 petabytes of disks at CERN, in the Geneva area, and in the other computer center across in Hungary. with a ratio which is more or less 60-40. So we are clearly aiming to have a system which is 50-50 across the two sides. The system we are, the software which runs on this is, a majority of the software we run on this to do the data management is, has been developed by us. And I will give a particular example. What is in this software is clearly, we are taking benefit of the recent, let's say, technology, although having to handle with such a large amount of data, of course, you should not expect that we go for buying the latest exotic device from the industry. We are going very much mainstream. So we go for example, SATA disks, much more than SSDs. We go for PCs, essentially only for PCs instead of going for special architectures. Otherwise, we could not really serve the users. Okay, this is a panel with a complete summary of what we are doing, just for reference. And here you see what happens, actually what was happening at the end of the proton-proton run in 2012 and in the short run beginning of 2013. So this is this system is our archival system, and this was, from all the experiments, receiving at something of the order of 10 gigabytes per second constantly over many months. This is just a September, December. The machine was stopped. People had also some Christmas break, and you see clearly the effect. Then the machine was restarted in another mode of operation, is ion proton, for a month, roughly. And then the machine was switched off. So then the rates went down considerably. EOS is the system we have for giving the data to users, so the analysis use case, if you want. And you see that physicists take a little bit of a break here on the Christmas, but in reality they are, here you don't see the effect of the end of the data taking, for example. And the reason is that we collected that year around 20 petabytes of data, and then this data had to be analyzed and reanalyzed many, many times. These analyses are still continuing. So essentially, this is kind of independent, in quote, from the data taking. So if from 2012 we go to now, we have changed the monitoring system, as you can see. And this is the total for the last month of data rates served by our systems. And we are essentially stably running around the 30 per second mark. This is integrated for all the experiments. With the big blobs, which are preparations for the LHC runs. And you see what happens in one experiment. This is just a breakdown. And you see that the experiment is reading analysis data between 5 to 12 seconds constantly. It's also injecting some more new data. And there is a little bit of archiving activity going on all the time anyway. I would like to zoom a bit on this EOS system, which is our system for analysis. This has been developed by us, so that's why we are also probably particularly proud. It's a system which now has roughly 140 petabytes of data of disks, which is used by, typically data are written twice. There are two replicas, and we'll go to that in a moment. So we can offer a total of 70 petabytes to all the experiments. And the original goal of the system was really to enable this large-scale analysis. So individual physicists accessing and wanting to go through their data very, very quickly. So these are the original goals. And now this system is in full production for physics and is also open to non-physics use cases, because it's becoming more and more a file system which can be used for any type of science. For example, initially we were concentrated on internal protocols, which were optimized for speed. More and more now we give the possibility to, for example, to fuse mount the system, so to have it like a fax system, or to have access via web dev, or to talk S3 protocol, which are popular, let's say, industry standards in this area. So how does it work inside? Now I will take probably 5 minutes on this. So as I said, it's a system is just large collection of disks. Okay. The typical machines we are buying now have a single machine has 48 disks, JBOD mode, so just a bunch of disks, and typically they are terabyte each. So if one of these square, these rectangles is a box, you should imagine that this box has roughly 200 terabytes in a box. And here I draw 20, so this is a 4 petabyte farm, represents a 4 terabyte farm. So every time a file is received from a user, this is written on two disks separately, and in a way that they are kind of mixed with each other. So for example, the yellow file is present on this disk and on this disk. The red one is present on this and on that. And the green will have a partner somewhere else. Important why this is interesting. As you know, disks do fail. Fail with the annual rates that in our case are order of a quarter of a percent. So once you start having thousands of disks, or 10,000 of disks, every day there are these failures. If we would have a single, every file would be just placed on a single disk, every day we would report about the file losses, because this dies, and all the files, the red, the green, and the yellow, are lost. So what we do is, first of all, we have this kind of second replica, or two replicas, there can also be more, which prevents us to failure in case this case would fail. The system reality is much more sophisticated. So, as you might know, some disks are giving some precursors of failures, which are called smart errors. So as soon as smart error is detected, for example, in disk A, we start draining out files. So you start with, I don't know, N files, and we say, okay, this disk is at risk. Let's try to empty it. So if it dies, nothing will happen. And for example, here you see that the red one is copied, second replica of the, actually it's a third replica for the moment, of the file is created over here. This is done immediately, but one should not imagine, that, you know, naively one could think, okay, to empty this disk, it will how much it will take? Okay, it will take the size of the disk, or the number of disk files, which are the use quota on the disk, divided by the network quota, then the network interface of the box. This is not true, because all the files here, in the case of, for example, two COP replicas, are also somewhere else. So the empty, logical emptying of this is actually a collaborative action on all the machines having either the yellow or the green or the red file. So we go much faster in reality. So even before having a failure, we can have some measures in order to minimize the numbers of files which are here. If at a certain point the file fails completely, all the incomplete replicas, so for example, the yellow has not yet been done, then it can be done, the second replica can be reconstructed from the external file. You can generalize it to case n equal to 3, n equal to 4, etc., but the logic is the same. So what if two disks are failing at the same time? So if two disks are failing at the same time, you will lose the intersection of files which are both on disk A and on disk B. Fortunately, the probability of this, instead of being the probability of an annual failure, goes with the square of the probability, because you have two events at the same time. And in reality, since we have the number of files on the disk A might even be quite small, because we have started to empty it quite even before the failure. This is TA minus delta. And if the second disk, let's say disk B, fails not too early, then there is a consistent amount of time to do the draining I was mentioning before. So at the end, the system does lose files in a controlled way, and predict and measure. Okay. Of course, it doesn't mean that we are losing LHC data. This we are using data which are used by the, let's say, temporary data for the analysis. The raw data from LHC and the fundamental data are going also to Telco. But this is the disk part. Any drawback in this design? The design, I think, is quite smart. But of course, every time you write your gigabyte file here, you will need another gigabyte somewhere else. And if you insist for having three copies, your overhead will be even 200%. So what we did is that we are implementing this scheme of distribution of files across this network of disks, similar techniques as what you get in RAID 6. So you create parity blocks, you create additional parity blocks, and so instead of, for example, losing or having an overhead of 100% like in two replica case, you have just, for example, 30% of overhead. A very nice thing, if you do this fragmentation, is that actually the system can be faster. Can be faster because in this case, in the replica case, if I want a read file, the system will tell me, go on this B, and I start reading. So at that point, I will be limited at least by the network card of the machine hosting this disk. If I have four or five fragments, the client will get every single fragment. So in reality, the speed will be higher than the maximum a priori or the maximum allowed from a single box network. So I spent a little bit of time because, first of all, I'm very proud of the system. And we did it, I mean, from A to Z. Second, because we are also starting collaboration with different entities to have it outside CERN. Here there is a reminder of this sophisticated two-site deployment, which to my mind is unique. So we have roughly 80 petabytes here and 60 petabytes there. And the system is capable really to work nicely in the sense that with two replicas, which is typically one here and one there, we can always give to CERN client the CERN replica and to Budapest, in quote, client, the Budapest replica, essentially beating the latency of these two links linking the two sides. Now I switch to another subject, which is cloud file synchronization and sharing. This is a kind of very important title for something you know very well. Many people are using Dropbox, and so they know what they're talking. And actually, I've just discovered that part of the system we are using is also used here, and it's called OnCloud. So why this is relevant for us? So as you have seen, we have majority of our users are not. They do have an office at CERN, but they spend a considerable amount of time in their university. So they are commuting a lot. And they are also collaborating with people which are, when they are CERN, maybe they are in the same office, but then when they go back, one is in Spain, one is in Italy. So synchronizing data and sharing across data is what we are doing all the time. This became clear 1 year ago, or a little bit more than 1 year ago, once we saw that many of our users are actually sharing data with using Dropbox, Google Drive, or other things. So since providing something which syncs files and shares files is so important, because it's really at the heart of what we are doing, we decided to provide a service, which tentatively called CERNBOX. But at variance with the previous system, we decided that instead of starting really from scratch, since we found some interesting building blocks, let's try to build from the building blocks. And the main building block with this, was this OnCloud software, which has had the two key qualities to become an interesting building blocks. First of all, it allowed us to have a solution where the data are in our computer centers. So it's not buying a solution or in another company. Second, is an open solution. So we control the software. Of course, we have a partnership with the company, but let's say we are completely in control. We can react to a bug or to a situation because we own the software. We don't own the software in the sense that it's ours, but we are part of the community using it. So with this situation, it was quite simple to start a good collaboration with the company. But immediately we said, yeah, but after all, we are special and we know our users are asking even more. So they are in love with the service, with the synchronization system. But very quickly they start saying, yeah, but what if I would ask you to have not 100 gigabytes, maybe a terabyte or 10 terabytes, etc. What if I would ask you to synchronize data with the data of the experiments? Of course, they cannot synchronize their experiment on their laptop. This is too much. But in particular, in non-cloud, you can say, okay, I would like to have a subset of the data synchronized, which I can use on my laptop in the train to do some development with a few data. I'm really convinced. I will send my program to analyze all the data on the CERN facility or on the WCG facility. So since there were all these kind of things, and since we believe that on one side scientific usage is very important, and secondly there is a lot to we can really do a nice progress by collaborating. Last year, we started a workshop, which we held at CERN, really around these cloud services and file synchronization. This was quite nice, in the sense that we, first of all, we discovered, oh, there is a big community out there using more or less the same tools and having exactly the same needs. The second thing we discovered is that there is a large interest in the industry. So without really advertising, we had five or six companies providing different alternative solutions with own cloud. And for us, it's also the way to progress. I mean, we invited also some people which are experts from the theoretical side. The workshop was really quite interesting. So the scenario we have in mind and we are enabling now is the following. So somebody has his laptop, for example, where he's synchronizing with some of the data. There are just the data he shares with some colleagues, for example. He has some programs and he has some of them synchronized. So all this is probably a terabyte of data. But he can also have the full data into the computer center. So once his job will be executed on the batch system, they will see not only the test data but all the other data. And as soon as the jobs are producing small outputs, which are much smaller than, let's say, the few petabytes he has to go through to get his results, can be synchronized back in a kind of lazy way. So this person will start from setting up a program, and then, kind of transparently, we start also getting the results in a way that we believe is really nice. So at variance with the CERN on cloud, this system allows a user to talk via the servers, to talk through the synchronization, but also to have programs submitted to our computer center and which are working the old styles of the open files, etc., without the synchronization client in between. Now this is a very delicate part because I'm not sure I will make it work.
No, we make it start. Yes.
Okay, this is an animation from a colleague. So this is the client, the CERNBOX client. This person is synchronizing his own directory and the experiment, part of the experiment data, of course. And now the person is on a machine in the computer center. This is an interactive front end. You can see that here the guy sees a system which has 6 petabytes of which has 11 petabytes of usable space, 6.6 of which are used. And now we'll create some files as on a file system. Let's copy, something on. Okay, so, and this is still on EOS, so the file has appeared. And after a while, the sync client automatically detects that there is a new file over there, and this is downloading on the machine. And this is also an explanation, shows also integration between different platforms, because at this prompt, the person has a machine which is a Linux SSC 6 machine, while the rest of the files and a lot of his activity happens on the on his Mac. Now, to conclude, to wrap up, I would like to go back to the data, physics, etc., to convince you even more that we, I mean, data are really at the heart of what we are doing, and the fact that they are so much is not a detail, is not a luxury, is the way it is. Physics is done like this, and we have to cope with it. What I, in the cartoon, I have two protons heading one to each other. You know, protons are actually composite objects with the quarks and gluons inside. And once you have a collision, normally interesting collisions are hard collisions between two components into the protons, while all the rest is wrecked, let's say, low and relatively low energy particles. So here in the cartoon, after the collision, I draw something which, okay, there are many debris which are not interesting, and then there is a Higgs boson created because the two partons had, the two partons had enough energy to produce it, and these then decays and produce, in these examples, four particles, which are four muons. Okay? This is one of the many ways the Higgs can manifest itself. So this decay is essentially takes no time. They are not, there is no Higgs flying into the detector. So immediately it produces these four particles. And here, here, you can see this is the Atlas detector. You see this is a real event. These are many, many tracks, this kind of yellow ochre. And then you see there are four prongs coming out and hitting the detector. Actually, they are crossing the detector inside out. And these are muons. Actually, the fact that they travel so long is a very good signature that they are muons. So this happens at the collision. Then in the reconstruction, you can probably see here, there are many, many hits. So these are signs of particles having passed through these different detectors. And what the reconstruction does is little by little finds path, which are, let's say, our estimate of the real particle trajectory through the detector. Done this, the data are, let's say, these are summarized in these reconstructed quantities data, which are going to the analysis, where the persons are trying to identify particles, select the interesting final states, compute, in this case, compute the parent mass from the energies of these four. And what is really essential is study all possible backgrounds and error sources. And once you are done, typically you have to redo it and redo it several times in order to optimize it and really get out the signal. Here, this is one measurement of the Higgs boson. The Higgs boson is represented by this peak here. The black dots are experimental data. The bluish shape going through here is what you would expect without having an LHC, any Higgs boson produced, because it simply doesn't, zero hypothesis does not exist. This is, and so the excess is a measurement of this particle. And how this is animated. What you should see is here goes with time. And this is June of the second year of data taking. It's only here you start seeing something creating a significant difference between the zero hypothesis and the Higgs hypothesis. So for all the data collected in the very, early months, they do count, but they do not show anything. You have really to go through the entire two-year data taking in order for this channel, so for this particular configuration, to go through and get this data. You see, we are in 2011, nothing is visible. May is probably visible. June, you start having a systematic things. July, August, only here you really start being confident that this is not a calibration glitches or a fake of the twist of statistics. It is really real. this is clearly one of the many different channels which have been used by the experiments. It really gives you the idea of how long it takes and the fact that one has really to go through the whole data. It's not, in our science at least, you really need the access to the entirety of the data set. So my conclusions is what I said is essential. It's not that we are doing big data because it's fashionable. It's what we are doing to enable physics to happen. More and more, we have been involved also in interdisciplinary projects. More and more, science needs this. Maybe sometimes it's more from the big data, big volumes, like us. In some cases, more maybe from the variety. In other cases, more from the velocity. But this is becoming, let's say, more and more broad field of collaboration between sciences and activities. Since it's so critical for us, we are developing, sometimes from scratch, something from existing building blocks, solutions which we think have a value which is broader than science. Of course, we are always going back to the fact that web has been invented at CERN to say, okay, probably everything we do is interesting for others. It's maybe not always the case. But in this case, in this particular case, with these two systems, I think we believe we have something which is interesting, also as a means to collaborate with companies and with universities. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, questions?
Yeah, imagine that we build now an accelerator which has 10 times the collision energy that we have now. Mm-hmm. How does the amount of information per second scale?
The two things are independent, in the sense that what makes the bulk, the for example, the roughly 20 petabytes we collected in the last round for the experiment, this is done by the fact that there are many, many collisions. The higher the energy, yes, there are more particles, so you can imagine that there is more, let's say every event, every collision is a bit more complicated. But what is really dominating is the number of collisions. So there are machines which are even much lower energy than this, which are competing. They are smaller, but let's say they are within the same range of size of data. Okay. So the two things we call one is the energy, the other one is we call it luminosity. So it's just like if you take pictures of the space. Okay, the granularity is one thing. But the other thing is how many pictures you take, okay? And typically we are dominated by how many pictures we take. We cannot take much more than that, for example. So there are discussions about machines with the higher energies, of course, there is always an order, right? But for the moment, we are still at the level of, it's more for the physicists, it's not yet a computing problem. But I would not expect, 100 times energy means 100 times the data, no.
You mentioned that in the experiments, in the Atlas sensor or whatever, there are some active sensing filtering process, right? Mm-hmm. And I guess that is necessary to not exhaust the capacity of your file system. But how do you handle mistakes in that filtering process? I mean, getting the system completely
overwrite. Yeah, fortunately, these, let's say, the selection algorithm are part of the experiment. So it's not our department. No, it's serious. It's really something which has to do with the data taking. I mean, you cannot observe everything. Okay, so you have to decide that you have to select, for example, events where there was something hard happening. Otherwise, there are many, many events which are, some of these events, but you take a kind of small percentage just for calibration, etc. But we know that we have, for some of these particles, you will produce, say, a few hundreds in a year. Okay, so it's very important that they have means to do it, to be sure that they will not reject a single one out of 100, but they really cut the others, so these kind of less interesting events. So then this is done at a different level. So the lowest level is essentially you don't even read the detector. Then if there is some, let's say, some energy depositions or some interesting patterns, then you start reading. And once you start reading, essentially you use the same algorithm which are used for the final analysis. So this really is, there is a reading, but they are, the data are not shipped to us. They are still next to the experiment. They are processed, and they are selected. Okay. And this is the last moment there is a real data selection. After that moment, once they close the file and they put it in the queue to be transferred, the data are, I would say, untouchable. These are the experimental data. These are the data we are meant to conserve or to preserve for many, many years. So in order to be sure that there are no bugs, let's say, at the level of selection, as everything in the experiment, you have extensive simulation. So there are programs which are capable to regenerate events which are essentially realistic, and then you can counter-check your program, your selection program against them. And the same programs are the ones which are producing this kind of colored line below this, red thing, because, again, you have to simulate your detector to a degree of finesse, which is really okay. Even for the debugging, I mean, a typical student arrives, has an algorithm to do something. How do you know? I mean, it's not obvious to use standard techniques like printing, you know, having some printouts in the program with this kind of thing. So the ultimate test is always against this kind of fake data, simulation data, for which you know what you have put inside, so you can close the loop. Okay. Oh, there are 10 particles. How many particles you have found? 22. Okay, probably it doesn't work. Or okay. Yes, please. Oh,
good question, actually.
So, the total budget, I don't know. So, because running the machine, et cetera, et cetera. What I can tell you is that the computing budget, so what we spend in hardware in the computer center, is dominated by data, but is of the order of 50%. So, out of our budget, we spend roughly 50% for disks and tapes, and everything which is around, while the computing nodes where the physicists are doing the reconstruction and the analysis, we spend another 50%, a little bit less. So it's a very important part.
Please. I am surprised to see tapes present at CERN. I don't know how. Was the technology now? The last tape I used was a DAT tape, so 15 years ago. So could you tell us something about which kind of speed or size or data of capacity do you have in actual tapes?
And also, you are surprised that we are still using them, right?
Yes, it's part of the question. No, the ones I used.
I was a student, and I was told by experts in storage that at that time I was not doing storage; I was doing physics. I was told, tape is dead since long. Okay. 30 years after, they are still dead, but they are in a good health. So, first of all, why we use them? There are essentially two main important reasons. One is, I mentioned that we had to do this complicated setup with the second computer center in Hungary. The one of the driving force of going that way was that we don't have enough power. So, a tape compared to a disk has a big advantage. Once you write your data, if you keep them on this table, this will be zero cost in terms of energy. Well, a disk, as you know, typically is a spinning disk. This is the first reason. The second reason is that once you delete a file on a disk, maybe by mistake, by an operational mistake, say, okay, I want to delete this file, and you know, you type another name, tap. In general, the file is gone from good. Because the reason is that, I mean, the disk is spinning, so the block you have just freed are being immediately reused by other activities of the machine, so the file is too late. If you do the same on the archival system of ours, what happens is the file disappears, so the user says, oh my God, it's gone. The disk copy, if there was one, is gone. We don't try to go there with an undelete program like maybe some old Windows version. But the file is gone just because we took it out from our catalog, and we have removed from the catalog the fact that there is a file called Massimo.dat, which was sitting on a tape called ABC and being filed on the on this thing. So in case of a mistake, the only thing we have to do is simply to reestablish this line, and the file is again available for the user. So since it's kind of static, the tape, the file is not reclaimed immediately by the system. And so we can survive, or the experiments can survive from a small mistake like this, because we can fix it. On the long run, after a couple of years, typically, or every couple of years, what we do is we take all the tapes and we copy them on new tapes to gain a factor of two of space, because new generation of tapes is as twice as much capacity. So only at that point, files which are, let's say, not referenced by anyone won't be copied. And then, only at that time the file could really go. So this is the fact that such a different time constant makes the data safe. About size, so if you have used them, say 15 years ago, they were the typical enterprise tape from IBM was this 3840 probably system, like a cartridge of this size, so not much bigger than a disk. At that time, probably was okay. 20 years ago, we were on the. The first of this series in the 1990 was 200 megabytes per box. Now the same form factor keeps about 7, 8, depending on the model and the brand, 7, 8, 10, almost 10 terabyte per box, which matches more or less with the disk size, order of magnitude. Just to tell you even more how these data are important for us. As I said, the first thing we do is that the data arriving, we put them on tape. So at that moment, we have one disk copy, one tape copy. Then we ship them into the infrastructure, in this WLCG, the Worldwide LHC Computing Grid. So shipping means that they hit one of the 13 tier ones, and they are recorded then there on tape. So roughly 10% of the LHC experiment, just to stay in Spain, to Barcelona. They are going to tape in our place. They are flying to Barcelona on tape on Barcelona. So even if we lose the computer center with the archive because of a fire, it will be a disaster, but all the data can be, reconstructed. Our archive can be reconstructed by taking the 10%, peak Barcelona took, and Bologna CNAF, and Fermilab in the US, etc., and recreate the data. As I say always, all the LHC is extremely complicated and also expensive, and you can also imagine how much time of people and effort, etc. Once you finish the experiments, all the legacy of this will be just the data, because at a certain point the experiment will be stopped, dismantled, or whatever, we go to the museum. So that's why we have this kind of paranoid attention to have multiple copies and all possible strings to secure the data.
What's the format of the data after one experiment?
Like the format of
the particular?
Okay. So what is, coming directly to us is a byte stream collection in a kind of, let's call it proprietary format, in the sense that every sub-detector of each detector, tries to pack as many bits in, as much information as little bytes as possible. So to this data are really, meaningless without an understanding of what is behind. And this is in order to have the maximum compression. After that, a priori everyone can quote, but in reality there is a format which comes from a tool which has been developed at CERN, which is called Root, being root on a machine, R-O-O-T, which among other things has a disk format to save C++ objects, let's say. So this is a kind of our lingua franca, so it's you could think to a kind of exchange format, okay? And this is used by essentially everyone. But this is for the analysis, this is the second level. The raw reads are byte streams, and typically you can prove that they are really compact, because typically if you take them and you try to gzip them, you don't gain, because it's really, you know, they know that what they are doing to the detail that they can use every single bit to play tricks of all kinds. So there is no, at the end of the chain, we have this root format. Recently, for the 60th anniversary, was last year, the people doing outreach, etc., from the laboratory point of view, they also put some data on the web. I don't know by heart the URL, but you can get CMS data on your laptop, let's say from home. There are pictures, but there are also data which have the full structure, and in certain cases, there are people doing it, you can you get the access to the data, you get a kit which is a virtual machine, with inside the virtual machine an exemplary program, so you can download this, start it on your laptop or desktop at home, and start downloading data, and create plots which are the same the experiment that the physicists are doing. So this is also possible. But it varies with other sciences like astronomy. There is not something like a general type stars, etc. This we don't have it. Well, probably yes. Let's say the more now is this is more and more true with time. But let's say the capability of taking the, of storing the data and also analyzing the data is an integral part of the experiment. Would not make any sense if it's a perfect experiment and then I'm not capable to. Okay, so we go through the design. The design of the detector continues, in some sense, in the design of the computing. There are, what is true is that there are failures in the system which can prevent work, and so everything else doesn't work, and there are failures which are preventing the experiment to work just because they cannot transfer the data. This is an hypothetical, let's say, scenario, but for which we have put in place, let's say, some measures. The experiments are at the experiment position from the computer center, and they send us data via fiber. If a fiber breaks, they will not be able to send data. This is okay because they have a local buffer, but if the fiber interruption lasts too long, then at a certain point the disk at the pit at the experiment will be full, and they will have to stop data taking. Okay, this is hypothetical. We have dual paths, etc., but we say hypothetically, you can have a situation where the experiment is blocked because you cannot take data for a computing problem and not for a computer. Not sure, did I answer?
Coming to this regarding energy, obviously the experiment takes a lot of energy, but how compare with the data storing and the system? How much energy do you spend?
You mean energy? You mean
like electrical energy?
Electrical energy. Okay. No, the machine, the LHC uses much more than 5 megawatts. Okay. And this depends on the fact that we can get substantial electrical power from France. And also this settles the typical CERN way to operate the system, which is, as I said at the beginning, probably from spring to late fall, early winter. The reason is that the cost of the electric energy in France, for power users, of course, is not constant. And during winter, it costs much more than in summer. So we try to say not to run in that period, we do other things, and to run in summer when it's cheaper. So this is what the accelerator does. In the case of the computer center, we have 5 megawatts in Geneva, and we are limited. Okay, globally we are limited by the 5 megawatts, but we are we could run more equipment if we could avoid cool the system, cool down the machine room, which is obviously impossible without doing important changes in the in the, in the building. Presently, once in summer, let's say we run at 3.5, more or less, megawatt, because we leave 60% of the total to be available for cooling. Of course, often it is not needed, or often, fortunately, Geneva weather is not always as nice as here, so the external temperature is such we don't have to spend too much for power, for cooling power, but we have entire cycle, so our center has, is written on one transparency as a PUE, electric global efficiency of, there's not an efficiency, is a ratio, is 1.6. So it means for every megawatt you use for computing, you have to have a 0.6 in your pocket to cool it down. And there are also, I don't have pictures, I mean close picture, we did also some kind of magic in order to try to keep to optimize the cooling in our computer center for different types. It has more to do with, let's say, it's not really high energy physics, but let's say trying to keep the temperature down. There are computer centers nowadays which have this ratio is essentially one. So for every megawatt, you don't have, essentially you don't spend anything in cooling, but these are special buildings built like a chimney a bit. So as soon you start having a little bit of heat, the heat itself goes by pulling in relatively more fresh air. I mean, fresher air. For example, we did studies on how, which was the maximum temperature we could afford without burn, let's say without damaging our system. So if you visit the computer room, it's not a usual computer room, you enter and you get a cold. No, it's typically it's warmer than is 26 degrees. Mm-hmm. And so these are the really the limiting factor on the computer side.
I have a question. How long do you expect to preserve the data? I mean, is all these events intended to be preserved forever? Is a policy that say after every so many years I revise which of these events should we really preserve, and the other ones, after have been analyzed, we can delete them? Or
I'm not sure in our, let's say, contract. It's not a contract. It's in our mandate. I don't think we say forever, but in practice, it's so. This is
a lot of cleanup. Of
the cleanup, we could do it, but in reality, I mentioned before in a question that after a while. We have a new generation of tapes, and then we copy the old of the new. So what happens after a couple of these cycles is that the experiments of, let's say, 10 years ago, yeah, we could go there and say, maybe this file is not interesting, but so what? Globally, they are so small, yeah, that is a perturbation. Yeah. So it will be more difficult to do this pruning than, yes. Because these experiments are essentially at the edge of technology. So it means that also the computing we were doing even in the past, the maximum which was, let's say, reasonable and affordable. So they are probably more or less along a, let's say, a Moore's law, more or less. So then after a few cycles, they are small.
It's not worth it. Yeah. At all.
Yeah. So that's why I remember very well the size of this cassette. Because this 200 megabytes, it sounded so important, and then all the experiment was in several, let's say, blocks of these things. And now would be zero. Yeah, I mean, the entire experiment would fit in my laptop.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.